Okay, I want to thank everyone for coming out on a very busy Halloween evening for Ron Wimberly's Prince of Cats, the official reissue, oversized, properly colored, with all of the extra in there that were edited out from back in the day. I'm Jonathan Gray. I'm a professor of English at the CUNY Graduate Center and all-around comics nerd. And so I look forward to asking you some questions, sir.
All right.
Hey. Is there an opening statement before we begin?
Yeah, thanks for not... thanks for filling up the seats. I was a little embarrassed. I was hoping someone came out. I mean, because it's Halloween. Everyone wants to, you know, dress up, party.
Yes. So,
well, thanks for coming out.
That's your opening statement?
I mean, that's my opening statement. What do you want?
So talk to us about Prince of Cats, its birth, and then the rebirth, because this is the second time around, and you're lucky because most books don't get a second chance at life. So talk to us about how it came to be, and then how it came.
Is that
to
Shalimar
be
second
again.
Time around?
Hey, easy.
Is it Shalimar? That's Shalimar, right?
Possibly.
Okay. Originally did Prince of Cats. Originally released in 2012 from Vertigo. Smaller format. Kind of rushed release, like it's a hurry up and wait comic book publishing type of deal.
Right.
I actually didn't even know when they announced the pub date, so like I found out via like the internet.
Sure.
So and then I was working on Black Dynamite at the time, and then it's like, oh well, I guess I better wrap this up. It was gonna be in the stores.
Right.
So yeah. As to the seed of the idea, like it came to me in bits and pieces, like from a young age, probably from watching Ron when I was like a little young one. The first version of Shakespeare I saw staged, you know, for better or worse, was Ron, like Kurosawa's Ron. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that. And growing up in DC and seeing like, thank God, not seeing any violence personally, but being around people who lived and witnessed that and kind of wondering why things happen. That was a seed. Mm-hmm. That tennis shoe scene in Prince of Cats actually happened to me.
Mm.
And then at a certain point, it just coalesced. You know, being in New York for about 15 years at the time and like watching, you know, 80 blocks from Tiffany's,
right.
And, you know,
right,
things
right,
like
right.
that, it just coalesced and pitched it to Vertigo, and they weren't very interested at first. But you know how it is, like, people caught up to the idea.
Right. Okay. And talk more about the very obvious Eastern influences on you, because I think that it comes through in all your work, and I really have never heard you, like just today you talked about, just now you talked about Kurosawa, and that's interesting to me that the first time you experienced Shakespeare was, you know, through that lens. Mm. So talk a little more about how you filter that, you know, you're a kid from D.C. Mm-hmm. who's lived for 20 years in Brooklyn,
mm-hmm.
but there's a way in which you're, you know, that the other part of your DNA is Tokyo, so talk a little bit more about that.
Well, it's interesting because I think growing up, if you're a kid growing up in the 80s, you have an affinity for a certain type of television. You know, like on Saturdays, we would get like television, we would get like Shaw Brothers. We would
Five
get,
Deadly
like,
Venoms.
Yeah, we would get like Toho and like, you know,
right.
all of that.
Right.
That sort of thing. And I think, I've thought long and hard about it. I think it was a space where you could observe another group, like outside of sort of like a white supremacist structure altogether.
Right.
Like different actors, different culture.
Right.
You know, and I think it was unique. It was like even more unique than say like Good Times, because like Good Times still exists within that sort of white supremacist structure. Like it's how these people are defined by this structure, by this world
right.
that we live in. But to watch another group of people, like, kind of like non-white.
Right.
With, I think.
So this is true escapism.
Yeah, I mean.
To watch the Asian people, the Asian others, is truly to get outside of the black,
Asian
white.
People, non-othered.
Right,
like,
no,
in
of course.
Space,
of
non-othered,
course. Right? Right,
right. So I think that was kind of like a radical thing to witness
right.
when you were young. Plus, it was violent, and like when you were a kid, like, you just love
violence. Is good.
Giant robots, like just this completely different imagination, cultural
right.
imagination,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was very liberating. And so from a very early age, I started to get sort of weaned on that,
mm-hmm,
you know. So
mm-hmm.
when I came into contact with international television, which I would watch sometimes subtitled, sometimes not,
right?
And I would watch like what is it? There's one Shogun show. There was like a Shogun show where he's kind of like in disguise, and it's
mm-hmm.
like a Chambara show, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I would wait and I'd watch these shows, thinking that at some point there's gonna be violence. And kind of Ron tricked me, because, like, I mean, Ron is full of violence.
Right.
But it also tricked me into, like, kind of experiencing King Lear before I was even, like, a teenager.
Right.
You know what I mean? So from that very early age, I was in, like, these sort of cultural, the various cultural languages of, you know, of Japan, of East Asia in general,
right,
were kind of imprinted on me. Also, economically at the time, like, our countries were having such an intense fight and or romance, you know, like,
yeah.
So when I was a kid, you know,
Japanese is taking, they're taking over.
Yeah, yeah,
right,
yeah, yeah,
I remember.
Yeah, like,
right.
Cars, like appliances, everything,
right.
Like,
right.
You could watch a TV show that was literally about American GIs, like G.I. Joe.
Right.
And then you get to the end of it, and every name in the list of the production was Japanese.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Right.
So, you know, I think even at that point, I was being informed by the aesthetics.
Sure.
So in a way that I don't think Americans haven't experienced with any, like, when else have we been influenced like that? Not by, like, say, the UK or something. I think
right.
second after the UK, the largest aesthetic influence, or even cultural influence probably at the time, would have been, you know, Japan.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So I think it's kind of, in a weird way, I don't think it's like deliberately racist, but I think it's kind of racist how people, they kind of think it's special when you're influenced by those things, where I'm kind of like, yeah, you know,
right,
if
natural.
It was like Lautrec or, you know, Sheila, people wouldn't ask me like, well, why do you have this European influence? You
right.
Like, it's
right.
like, yo, we're visual artists, so,
sure,
you know,
sure,
it's definitely
sure.
part of our language.
Okay, of course, of course. So speaking of art, one of the things that I admire in your work is your use of color.
Mm.
So talk to me a little bit. I mean, even, like, I have the original Vertigo version, and just sort of flipping through this version, because it's been recolored and sort of remastered to use.
Well, yeah, remastered. The color is mostly the same. There are a few pages where I changed a little something, but
okay. All right,
for the
well
most
then.
Part, it's just like me. Yeah, I mean, every time something gets printed, I don't know if any of you guys have worked in print, but every time things get changed a little bit, depending on, like, the printer or whatnot. So, but I did change a couple of things. I mean, it's Easter egg, if you guys can find it. I don't know if you anyway.
Sure, but my larger question is about your use of color, because
okay.
I feel like of I mean, it's such an interest, you pay special attention to color. You use color in a way a lot of artists don't. And so I'm just trying to get a sense of that. I mean, it provides a real texture for your work. And while I'm here thinking it's also about your work on She-Hulk, how you would, like, give her different, her green would be different based on if she was in the sun or if she was in shadow or if she was wearing a brown jacket, because of course the brown would, like, sort of mute
right.
her. And so you really think through these things, and I mean, you
light
see
color
it here.
Design, freshman of Pratt, you know what I mean?
Oh,
like,
boy. Is it really that simple?
Well, that's what the She-Hulk thing is, but
right.
I kind of, you know, I started to, yeah, we already talked about my kind of like aesthetic background, like things that inform what I'm into. And in my work, like, this book is almost, it's weird. I guess every work is biographical, but this one I feel is, like, particularly biographical if we start to think about my aesthetics. Like, from the cover, like, the cover is, the cover is kind of sampling Taranori Yoko's poster that he did for, I think that was for Battles Without, what is it, Humanity, I forget the name of it, it was a Yakuza film.
Mm-hmm.
And if you see in like the special edition,
can I give you a special edition?
The special edition has like a more deliberate sample. You can even see in the original,
mm-hmm.
Battle Without Honor or Humanity, I think is the name of it.
Mm-hmm.
There's a hand on the top. It's a Yakuza hand with a removed finger.
Aha, uh-huh. Here's and in the special edition. We can see
you can see
top.
Like it's a more direct sample. So like those posters, Taranori Yoko, like avant-garde theater posters from like the 60s in Japan had a profound influence on the way I thought about design.
Mm-hmm.
The color of the posters, not so much the actual fresh posters, but aged posters.
Ah.
The colors of, say, graffiti on old walls, old graffiti.
Right.
Like, and cats going over the old with new, fresh colors.
Right.
It kind of fit in with, like, when I was a kid, somebody said, like, a woman told me, she was like, oh, your color sense is kind of like Shibuya. And I was like, well, what does that mean? So I started to look it up. And I was right. like, well, I looked up Shibuya. And from that point, I started to think about like, okay, well, I want to deliberately do what I have been doing and
right.
kind of think about like what it is. How could I continue to develop that sense?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's where I get my color usage. On this, it's very vibrant. It's closer to like the theater poster stuff, but like, always I'm thinking about that. She-Hulk is more just like, why would she be the same color if she's like indoors versus outdoors
of course.
Versus natural light versus whatever.
Sure, sure. I mean, that's what I liked about it was, it was confusing at first because she's always colored the same way. Then I was like, oh wait, I get what he's doing. Right?
It's also confusing because I didn't color the whole book. Like,
right.
yeah.
So you have the Marvel color
yeah.
going, what's he doing?
Yeah.
And they're not really thinking this stuff through.
It's a sausage factory.
Well, yeah.
Comics is a sausage factory.
And we don't ever want to see how the sausage
no,
gets
no,
made.
No, you don't.
Right. But actually, speaking about that, and this is the, I know this is the question that makes you roll your eyes, but can you talk about... you know, there aren't a lot of... you've been in comics for a decade now?
Oh, man.
More than a decade.
Yeah, more than a decade.
And
like,
there aren't a lot of black creators in comics, right? Particularly when I say black creators, there are a lot of black artists, but there aren't a lot of people who conceive of and then bring their own stories to light. And so talk about, you know, those struggles as well, because, I mean, that part of that is... It's part of the reason this was treated the way it was treated, right?
Oh, you mean at Vertigo?
No, I mean in general, but of course, where, you know, you can talk about it in general, but also tie it back to the thing that we're celebrating.
That's a good question, man. Like, more and more, I want to be open to the idea that there are more creators out there, that maybe we're not seeing as much, or maybe they're not at Marvel or DC.
You know, of course.
I know, like, there's a gang of cats from Richmond, Virginia, like,
yeah,
you know,
they're doing their thing.
Richie,
mm-hmm.
Visions, Kindred, mm-hmm. you know, White, like, it's a lot of, like, you know, so.
I mean, but you have a unique point of view because, again, you've been more than a decade in the game.
Taylor.
And so those dudes are, you know, they sort of have half your lifespan in terms of putting work out there, so that's part
make
of what I was trying to get.
Old, though,
I'm not trying to make you sound old. You know, black don't crack, homie.
Yeah, all right.
I know you. I know you
yeah.
guys started when you were 12. So,
yeah, yeah,
you know.
Right. No, I'm not one of them. I actually started late. For you hear about all those guys, like the '90s guys started when they were like 13 or 14 or something.
Well, yeah. I mean, I know Frank Miller started when he was 17.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So
no. Yeah, man. Like it is messed up. Like it. You know, but I think it's just like anything, unless we kind of make a deliberate... First of all, the people have to be exposed to the language and see it as, you know, a viable means of expression. So I think one of the problems is like when I grew up, people read and consumed a lot of different things, but they didn't necessarily see a viable path towards like creation or contributing it in my particular how I grew up.
Right.
So even the fact that I drew, like nobody knew what to do with me. Like people didn't know where I was gonna, you know, like what do you do with that? You can make Hallmark cards or something. You know, like they had no idea. Like, you know, I don't even think people understood, made the connection between like say animation and drawing.
Right.
You know?
Like, right.
So I think for one of the things I've noticed is like I've met some people who kind of grew up in environments where there were people who fostered that sort of path, and like maybe even their parents or their relatives knew graphic artists or knew people like that. In my particular background, how I grew up,
right,
I didn't know, you know, like I didn't know many people. I can't speak to like, you know, the Black experience like that, but I think like the more we kind of put that out there, that
right,
people can do. You got it. The more we put it out there, like the more likely we are to have a vibrant and diverse. But with Tumblr right now, it's like so many kids making comics.
Right.
I almost feel like instead of asking people, like just stop buying those Marvel books. You know what I mean? Like
right,
if you mad at how they represent you, or you mad that nobody's in there, like yo, just stop buying them.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like if you don't, you know, start giving your bread and attention to people who are making the work that you like. You know what I mean? I know this is a store and people, you guys got to sell comics. I mean, Terrence, I didn't mean to like, you know. But like, yeah, I mean, that's kind of how I feel about it.
Right.
Why would you want to be in that environment? Like, I saw something on Twitter the other day where like this woman, she did one of the superhero characters and she put like a t-shirt on it and like they basically just trolled her off the internet with that. I'm like, oh, why do you even want to be in that environment? Like, right, why do you even want to go there? You know, like, at a certain point, it's like they're not getting my money or attention.
So for me, it's interesting to make this, take this a little bit wider, because there's a way in which we are in a cultural moment that could be understood as like peak Blackness.
I heard that.
Right?
Before.
Yeah. No. This is like a little theory going on right now, because if you think about how many television shows there are, how many movies there are, it's like, oh, Birth of a Nation is a flop. That means there's not going to be a Black movie nominated for it. Oh, wait, yes, there is, because yeah, Moonlight's going to get nominated for every Academy Award.
Who's seen Moonlight? I haven't seen it yet.
It's incredible. It's incredible. Anyway, and, you know, just looking at all of the cultural production and all of the influence and everything else, and yet, despite the fact that we are in this moment, like the one culture industry that's somehow successfully resisting peak Blackness is the comics industry.
I don't know if it is though. Like, I mean, I think if you're not on the internet, sure. But
right.
I think, like, man, Spike Trotman?
Yeah, no, Spike is killing it. Yeah, she's doing her thing.
Yeah, yeah. No.
She's incredible.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
So, like, I think, you know, there's this tendency for people to, like, okay, it's not Ta-Nehisi Coates. Like, you know, like, good on him, but like that's within these structures that are kind of like
right,
broken. Like, look at Spike, yo. Like, that's the future. Spike is the future.
Right. If you guys aren't following Spike Trotman on Twitter, find her on Twitter, and then all good things will happen.
I hope you like Lube. If you like her work,
hey,
you gotta see
some of it's all ages.
Yeah.
She does like two all ages books, and then she pays the bills with those other books. She's incredible. Speaking of, talk about the things, the 17 bazillion things you're currently working on.
Because
you got a lot going on, homie.
I got a lot going on.
He needs an assistant. Anyone out there want to help?
I need a coloring assistant.
Yeah, he needs a colorist, seriously.
Flatter. Yeah, so what else just came out? Attack on Titan came out.
Let's talk about
you want to talk about things that haven't come out yet?
Yeah, you know what I want to talk about. Jesus. Come on now.
Yeah, I'm working on a book called Sunset Park.
Yes,
and
indeed.
It's, you know, slowly but surely. Yeah, yeah. And it's a romantic horror story set in contemporary, mostly in contemporary New York. It's a romantic horror, so, you know, it takes place in several times.
Right.
But largely in, a lot of it is in contemporary New York.
Mm-hmm.
But just like New York isn't even in contemporary New York. Like the buildings, the streets, you know, less and less, but the history is there. It's like part of the patina of like the city.
Right.
And yeah, I'm just grinding that out. And like the unflattering part of what I do is just like this day to day. I have another project dropping in February I can't really talk about yet, but like I got about I got about half a month's work on that I need to finish. And those are the two big things I'm working on right now. I did some work on LaShawn Thomas's project for Crunchyroll that they announced.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I can't wait to show the designs for that. They were really cool.
And Attack on Titan, I'm sorry.
Attack on Titan is dope. Maybe like
rush past the thing that just came out. Go ahead, talk about
it. It's Attack on Titan. It's got Bloomberg as a Titan. It's got Axel Alonso as a Titan. It's got Trump as a Titan. Like, come on. Robert Moses as a Titan for all the old heads and historians out there. You know what I mean? Like, so it's my take on that. It's my attempt. I gave an attempt at doing like a Brechtian comic. A Brechtian comic.
No, you said it right the first time. Okay. So now I want to ask you about the thing that I can't talk about, which I know anyway.
I got to finish this one before I start on that one.
I know. All right. It's good. Talk a little bit about gentrification in Sunset Park. For me, that's the thing. That's not going to spoil any plot details, but this is the...
But we can talk about this gentrification even in Prince of Cats.
Right.
Like, there's a conversation between, before Act 1, Scene 1, like Shakespeare's Act 1, Scene 1, Samson and Gregory have a conversation about how the neighborhood is changing.
Right.
I think it...
So this is a reoccurring motif in your work, so talk about
it. It is, man. Like, I heard something about how we're, like, even not even in gentrification anymore. We're, like, in post-gentrification. So right. I think that's like a wise ass thing people do. Like, you know, they say like, oh, art is over, or like post-modernism. You know what I mean? Like, I think post-gentrification is kind of like that. But I think for me it's interesting, particularly being upwardly mobile, you know, hopefully cementing myself into middle class, but not quite yet.
Right.
Artist, it's like I'm the shock trooper of gentrification. You know what I mean? Like, I show up, like I'm like the black guy that makes people comfortable to live in a neighborhood, you know what I mean? For better or worse, they just can't tell what I'm thinking, you know. So like, for me, it's been
it's like, he wears ironic sweaters, we like him.
Right. They don't know, like, I'm the first guy to get a pitchfork when the revolution comes. I kill my friends first. Give them some mercy, you know, like they don't want to live through, like, you know, gulag or whatever, you know what I mean? So
gentrification is sort of touched upon a little bit here, in this scene.
Because they're eating at a really nice restaurant.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right,
it's
right,
like, right. Everybody likes to eat at a nice restaurant. They don't actually like to pay the nice prices, right? But like, they like to eat well. And you can eat well, actually, in a restaurant that doesn't cost a whole lot of money. Or at least you could at one point in time in my neighborhood, but not so much anymore. We got El Cofre. Yes. What else we got? We got some Mexican spot. The Finch is not... No, wait, I'm talking about like...
You're talking about a cheap spot?
Okay. Yeah.
So just FYI, we are neighbors. So yeah. That's the other thing is that in addition to...
He lives above the bodega.
Yeah, I do.
So it informs all of my work, because often when I'm working, I have to pay the rent.
Right.
And like, it's one of the things you think about nowadays. You think about this all the time, for better or worse. I'd rather not think so much about it. You guys seen Rear Window? I think it's in Rear Window where like they asked Jimmy Stewart. He's like, yeah, so what inspires you to take all of these photos? And he's like the landlord, like rent. Man, it's rent. You know what
gotta
I mean?
Get this money.
So the inspiration goes into, you know, that inspiration goes into the work. I moved around so much, like actually, Before I finished Prince of Cats, I finished it when I was in L.A. But before I finished, I started it when I was in, or started the drawing in Crown Heights. Mm. By the time I finished the drawing, I had to move out of Crown Heights. That was like 2011, maybe, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then I finished it in L.A. while I was working on Black Dynamite. So that's why it's in all of my work. And it's something I'm working through, like many things that I'm in my books is something I'm working through. You know, and this is kind of like also youth violence and language, and
right.
There are formal things I'm working through too, you know. So yeah, that's why it's. I mean, and that's why.
Okay. Now, of course,
Sunset Park is like it's poetic, you know, like.
Right. And just spill the central conceit of Sunset Park, which is not a spoiler, but I think people will be interested.
No, I don't know if I can tell people that.
Okay, never mind then.
It's so obvious. I mean, it's such a good idea that I can't let it out because then people can will finish another book with this
before I finish my book. Okay, fair enough, So we're going to come back here like in a year and have this
hopefully less than a year.
Less than a year, but we'll have this, we'll pick this up right there. So, and there is the obvious thing.
The poster lets you know. If you saw the image poster, like, it spills the beans.
Right. And then there's one more thing just, and it's this is the obvious thing, so I put it off to talk about these other things. But, so talk about hip-hop as, you know, we talked about the Eastern influences on your work. Talk about how the role that hip-hop plays in sort of your work from Prince of Cast to Sentences to Sunset Park and all these other things.
Well... I think the hip-hop thing is just as organic or, in some cases, inorganic as the Japanese influences.
Right.
Like, some things about hip-hop are very, you know, it's organic, meaning like, but in some ways I consume hip-hop, you know, like, just as, I went to Park Go-Go's, you know, like, I'm from D.C., you know what I mean? Like, you know, yeah, like, we had a different thing we were doing. They were a little, you know, we did do our little freestyle, it was somewhat organic, but D.C. is not, like, that close to New York, you know what I mean?
Yeah, you're right.
So in a weird sort of way, that's why it always bugs me out when people ask me about, like, Japan versus any other sort of influence I have. Like, yo, if it's punk or, like, hip-hop, it's like, I'm not that old. Like, I wasn't there for that.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Right.
But, like, I speak the language, and maybe because of, like, similar ways I'm othered, as the, you know, the people who make hip-hop,
right.
I identify with it, you know, like, it was something that we had, like, you know, like, all of black music is, like, something we have.
Right.
and with Sentences, Prince of Cats, like, anything that I do, it's part of the language. I would say the thing that's most evident in my work that I probably pick up from hip-hop, which is not unique to hip-hop, but also part of, like, the jazz tradition,
sure.
is... smashing things and putting them back together with like other things, you know what I mean, like sampling or like
there's a fancy word for that,
or like
pastiche, homie.
Okay, yeah, all right.
I mean, so you're engaging in a postmodern pastiche.
Kind of, but like I think what pastiche connotes also like a rigid sort of kind of like adhering to a mode of creation, right? Where, I mean, maybe, you're the professor, you tell me.
Yeah, no, I mean, pastiche can work on a whole bunch of different levels, and so if you're conscious of mashing things up just to see what's happening, you don't have to privilege any of the forms. But yeah, no, so for me, I mean, this...
Listen to that school talk, though.
What? Huh? Anyway, for me, this, I love this.
Oh, that's the homie Jordan.
So this isn't you.
I did not create that. Jordan Haley created that. But it's brilliant because it really embodies like the entirety of the story.
Right.
That's why for the cover I gave the hardcover to Jordan because like he did such a fucking amazing job.
Oh, I didn't even know it was on the
Yeah.
Okay.
So
thank you for seeing.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. Okay.
I asked Jordan, you know, Jordan helped me out on a lot of things. Like, he did that graphic, the graphic on the back, and he even flatted some of the book, I think, when I was in L.A.
Okay.
So, another frat homie, we went to school together.
Right. Actually, you know what, let's talk about that. Talk about collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's always the, you know, the cult of the artist, like, you know, Ron Wimberly, the soul genius who creates... you know, work of this sort, but, you know, like you said, you're like, oh, this is Jordan, this is, you know, this, you know, woman in my past who told me that my color sense is here. So talk about all the different collaborators you've worked with, from teachers to people who you're actually producing with.
But that gets into the sampling thing too, right? It's
right.
kind of like contemporary collaborators and dead collaborators, because like a good quarter of this book is just, I think, Shakespeare, you know, like
of course,
you know, act one, scene one is in there. I guess so, and after, you know, there's actually, it's a little less than a quarter, but I used some of the original Shakespeare in it. Yeah, I don't know, man. I think for me, it hasn't always been deliberate. With something like this, it's just, you want the homies, like part of working with people is like having collaborators. It's like, it's a joyful thing, you know?
Right.
If I have an opportunity, like to get somebody on to work with me, like I do, you know? If I see like part of Sunset Park too, I'm putting together something where I can hopefully have like six people do like a guide-in in it, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, and part of that is just like, yo, like let the homies get some, like let,
right.
you know.
Right.
And also, if you're not open to, in the case with Natsuko, like a friend of mine from back in the day,
mm-hmm.
brought that up, if you're not open to that sort of influence, like I think you're kind of dead in the water. You have to like always, if you're an artist, you have to be, maybe you don't take it all on and put it all out, but like I think you gotta at least kind of be receptive to the voices that, because really, yeah, it isn't like an individual creating in a vacuum. Really, it is about being open to letting the world around you speak through you, I think, too.
Right. Okay. So, in the spirit of the openness, any questions from the crowd for the brother Ron Wimberly?
Don't be shy.
I know. Please don't. Yes.
Okay,
so the question is, what's the status on Martin Luther King and slave punk for those who...
Martin Luther King. It's Saul Williams' book.
Oh, that, yeah, oh yeah. Good Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, there's a whole story there. Yeah, that's yeah. funny.
No, I mean...
You want to tell that thing?
Yeah, no, I could tell it. Like, I'm not working on that anymore. I think I did some artwork for it. But it's still coming out. It's coming out through First Second. It just got to a point schedule-wise where I couldn't, you know, and they got somebody else dope, and it'll be out from First Second. I'm not sure exactly when, but it's coming out. The record is already out now, and it's dope.
Yeah, the record's been out for a minute.
It's good work. Videos are out. It's amazing.
Yep.
Slave Punk is what I work on when I finish Sunset Park.
Yeah.
I was asked to announce both, and here we are.
Right.
So, like, basically being held accountable by the people. I've started trying not to mention it. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I started doing research. Like, I'm a type of person, like, I gotta create a stew. Part of what it is like, you know, I read, I forget, and then I go back in. I already have a structure for the story, but there's so much material, rich material out there, like first-person slave narratives, like a lot of history, that I want to be a part of the mix of it. So yeah, it's gonna come, y'all. I mean, like, I honestly think, like, even the name Slave Punk probably already spawned some other works which I'm happy about. One of the reasons I was excited about Eric wanting me to announce that is for that reason. Like, the name is kind of like a bit of culture hacking. Like, I wanted to kind of put the seed of the idea out there that, like, maybe if we're looking at STEAM as a sort of science fiction or speculative fiction source of energy, cultural, the labor, you know, or like even capital, right?
Yep.
What about the capital of the body? And like, we already have that. It's not even science fiction, but like, maybe, you know, just to consider like soft machines, to consider human beings as like technological capital.
Yeah, so there's an argument in the academy that...
The academy?
Stop it, shush. but there's an argument that that modernity is not produced by technology, but by slavery. Right, and so that like Europe enters modernity precisely at the point when they can exploit us and then use the extra time to think and then invent.
Mm.
So it's like, oh, we got slaves, and now we can, you know, oh, let's think about, you know. And
well,
that,
that's the
that
truth
pushes,
of the matter, like,
right, yeah.
with the Age of Enlightenment, whether what, you're
right.
talking about colonialism, slavery, or even domestically,
right.
Women kind of doing all the work in the
of
house
course.
So that, you know, like, fucking, you know, Gaston can go off and fuck around with his, like, you know, chemicals and shit.
Yeah, but it's, I mean, even like Wordsworth, like Wordsworth was living off of the money that his family had from a sugar plantation.
Oh, well, would you
and
look
so
at
he's
that?
Chilling, like able to write these beautiful poems in part because he don't got to work. Mm-hmm. Why? Because the slaves was in Jamaica working for him. So there's.
Well, it's funny because when you think about it like that, you could even think about, I mean, if you're talking about fine art and a lot of these artists today, it's kind of the same thing though.
That's true.
The exploitation
mommy's
of
paying
labor.
The rent.
Yeah.
Mommy's paying the rent, so you can do that thing. There was another hand up in the back though. Wasn't there? No?
Nah.
Okay, someone's ducking.
He's any bullying.
Other, right? I'm not trying to be
bullying a question.
Shush. Any other questions? Yes, hi.
Can you tell me about writing and you
were doing
like
art? Oh, yeah.
Could you talk a little bit about how you design pages such that the eye is going to scroll all the way through? Oh.
I got so much stuff I forget what I'm actually working on. Writing in is another thing. It's like Gekiga, like seinen, shonen, that takes place in Brooklyn, and it's also kind of about gentrification, post-gentrification. It's a shout out to Shirato Sanpei, and like he did a lot of work that used sort of genre, shinobi genre, to talk about, you know, political issues, to the extent where I think he kind of gets not a lot of love in the West because his ideas were so radical, but like he's just as important as like any of that wave of mangaka. Anyway, every time I do a comic, like I think about what my formal constraints are going to be, right? Like, so if it's a book, like I think, okay, well, with Prince of Cats, it's like I'm doing something that references works that are sonnets, poetry. So that's why I came up with the ABABCC page structure, because like I wanted to think about the formal constraints of the medium. With the phone, it's similar, and the endless scroll, I had to think about like, well, it doesn't make sense to kind of just pour over the same story structure from like a page, a flat, and like how could I recreate sort of the, not one-to-one recreate the experience, but have an experience that's engaging on the phone. So like I thought about breaking out of the panel structure altogether. At first I did I designed the pages so that I could do them both as comic page and as scroll. But as I moved on, the process changed. It went from that to just like creating images and then kind of editing them in Photoshop in the scroll. But then that was like a little bit it wasn't sensual enough. So like whenever I use a computer, like one of the treats for me is just to work with paper. It's not necessarily as efficient as working directly on the computer, but sometimes like I'll give myself something to look forward to, so like a new tool or working on paper. And that's what I did. So I started to work on like a large animation vellum with the rows on it. And then working like that too allowed me to visualize how the space can change and how the story can move through the space. It's maybe a little difficult without a particular case. For instance, like, so if you're scrolling down, you can see it's very different. You don't have like the Western sort of panoramic way of thinking about things, but you give yourself a new sort of way of distorting space so that you could have a character walking through a space, similar to like what animators do when they have the truck shots, but moving down. So I used that. I mean, I used a lot of little tricks. None of them were really new.
Right.
And honestly, I'm just surprised. Like a lot of, I feel like a lot of Korean phone comics use some really innovative things. And on Tumblr, like there's a lot of brilliant Tumblr artists who don't even, you know, they just have the characters moving through a space abstractly. Mm-hmm. I thought about that and I tried to develop some of my own stuff, but you know, I did a Gratman comic before where I did something similar, like long panoramic. It's kind of sad though, because I do like to use the sort of, you know, the good, the bad, and the ugly. But you have to think, well, what is that? What does the good, the bad, and the ugly do with the, you know, panorama? So like, think about, well, spatially, what works or what is unique about this? And it's kind of like the pan down,
right?
Like kind of obscuring foreground space and like moving backwards and forwards, seeing far out into the distance. And also thinking about like what someone called, I don't remember what they call it, but like an ukiyo-e, where you kind of flatten out the space like isometrically. Mm. So thinking about that and like mixing all that together. The space is just bugged in that comic. Like, it makes no sense, but it's like it's its own space. Like, that's the world that they're in. So, but did I answer the question?
All right.
We have two parts of that.
Okay.
First one is, I wanted you to kind of elaborate on like the limericks that you have in Prince of Cats. Mm. And the second one is, I want to know when I can get a prototype of the Adidas skills.
Oh, wow.
Some of these are called Kanye.
Yeah.
That shit will never happen.
Well, never
say never. We're in New York City.
But like, yeah, that I think you got to get those on Fulton. That's what that is. You know what I mean? If there was still that on Fulton, it's kind of difficult. I don't know. Has anyone gotten kicks on Fulton in the last like 8 years or so? It's wild now. It's like a mall.
They have a couple of spots on Fulton still.
That's what you do. You get your Adidas, right? You get a fresh pair, right? You get a pair of Geta. You go in, you hand them both, and you're like,
hook it up.
That was good. He'll be like, say no more. Say no more, fam. I got you.
And then, but there was two parts.
And what was the first part?
The limericks.
The limericks. Yeah, man. So, like, I had this bad joke that a friend told me a long time ago. And because I wanted to put it in the book, but I kind of gave myself a rule where, like, if I could, any and all times, use, like, a new... or use a sort of a poetic form to like insert that in there. So that's why I chose the limerick for Petruchio's limerick that kind of gets replaced. And you notice like Tybalt sometimes speaks in a haiku. So like, everybody has like a little thing that they like to do. Mm. And the limerick, yeah, that was Petruchio's thing. I figure it's like a dirty joke, so it's a terrible joke, and I'm very sorry I subjected you guys to that joke.
All right, other questions?
Nope.
One more.
No.
What are some of these tumblers that have?
That is a good. I was gonna ask.
Yo, my tumblers are like kind of a meta. They're kind of like, yo, if you want to know more about like Sunset Park, if you just tag Sunset Park, no spaces, and Sunset Park with a space, because I kind of like was working that out, like all of my, you'll start to see what I'm working with. Like I put on Tumblr, I just repost or like put posts out that kind of are part of my process, like how I'm thinking. Like if I see something, I'll scroll through and I'll be like, okay, well, this speaks to the project. Prince of Cats has a whole Tumblr. I think it was like 2 or 3 years long of just like everything from like the ballet to like the music references, 80 blocks from Tiffany's, all of that clothing. I just put it up there because it's actually a way of looking into the thought process behind it. It's not, sometimes it's after what I've done, but like often it'll just be like, oh, I found something kind of dope. I'm going to put it up there, you know, and it's free. So like, use it.
So now you were talking earlier though about some really amazing tumblers out there. Mm. So let's, you know, give us three that you should say, yo, go home and check out these three people.
I gotta look because I just look at the feed now. I actually haven't added a new person for a long time.
Okay, fair enough.
Fair enough. I got a few that were like kind of Andy Warhol, Basquiat based that I keep.
Mm.
I don't know, man. Can you remember a Tumblr handle like that? Just off the top of the head?
But I would just be able to say, you know, it's like Joe Smith's Tumblr. I don't know what the handle is, but it's Joe Smith. So, but now if you can't, I mean, so what you're basically saying is go look at your Tumblr feed
and you'll see some reposts too.
Right. Okay. Yeah, he has three though, so make sure
that you know of.
Oh shit. He has three that I know about, but you can find them all if you search Ron Wimberly, D-Pi.
Yeah, it'll pop up.
It'll pop up. So
watch out with D-Pi though, because like somebody got that URL. It's not like it's not me no more.
I think it
means something different.
Oh, okay.
It means something different somewhere else.
Fair enough. Yeah. Good luck. Oh dear.
Yeah.
All right.
Sorry.
Any other inquiries in the crowd? If not, please join me in giving a hand to Ron Wimberly.
Thank you. Thanks for coming out.